You are watching Germantown Municipal Television, your source for everything Germantown.
Welcome to Mid-South Matters. I'm your host, Ruth Dunning. Recently, President Obama issued an executive order to enact greater gun control regulations as a result of the high number of mass shootings. The order called for expanded background checks and requires firearm dealers to register as licensed gun dealers. Joining me to discuss the role of guns in today's society is Chad Uhiren. Chad is a magna cum laude graduate of the University of Memphis, from which he has both a bachelor's and a master's degree in criminology and criminal justice. Mr. Uhiren is the criminal justice teacher at Houston High School, formerly a Memphis police officer and currently a reserve police officer. Chad is also an adjunct professor at the University of Memphis, where he teaches Introduction to Policing. Welcome, Chad.
Hey, great to be here. Thank you for having me.
You are a busy man. That sounds like three jobs.
And have a 3.5-year-old and a baby coming next month.
So very good.
We stay busy in the Uhiren household.
So very good.
Thank you for having me.
Let's talk a bit about the Second Amendment.
Okay.
There seem to be about four different points of view.
Mm-hmm.
One, the very extreme left,
right,
that wants absolute, maybe all guns gone,
mm-hmm,
you know, and says the Second Amendment only deals with police and et cetera.
Right.
There's another center left that's in favor of a Second Amendment and gun ownership, but with very, very strict regulations. There's another group that is going to go further and say we can have almost every kind of gun, military weapons, etc. And then there's a fourth group that says we don't want any registration, we don't want anything. So I'm going to ask you, in these four categories, where do you fall?
Well, you know, the Second Amendment, gun control, obviously is a hotly debated
mm-hmm
topic.
Mm-hmm.
People have varying viewpoints on it. You know, some people, like you said, are more liberal with it. Some are more conservative. I happen to fall, if I was going to pick a spot, probably that third one that you
category
mentioned.
Category.
When you talk about gun control, you really have to focus in on kind of what's appropriate, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
What's necessary to defend yourself, to defend
mm-hmm
innocent third-party people. And you really have to look at ways to try to keep people that shouldn't own guns from having guns, because that's where the problem lies. It's not with the people that are responsible, law-abiding
mm-hmm
citizens.
Now, let me stop.
Mm-hmm.
In this third category,
right,
you would believe that you should be allowed to have what we're calling military-type weapons, AK-47s, et cetera, et cetera. And you explained yesterday to me a very good reason why you are kind of in that category.
Right. Well, typically what you'll see with most police officers is we tend to be gun fanatics. We enjoy guns. I own quite a few guns myself. When you talk about this military type, especially when you talk about like AR rifles, the ones that they're always showing on television,
mm-hmm,
basically what you're referring to is still a semi-automatic gun. Which many of the hunting guns and things like that, pistols that we have, operate off the same mechanics.
Mm-hmm.
Every time you pull the trigger, that's one shot. It's not a full auto caliber weapon.
But isn't it fairly easy to convert?
If you know what you're doing,
yeah,
if you know what you're doing, you could convert it. Mm-hmm. You would obviously have to have knowledge of how to do that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You could convert it, absolutely. But I know with my own preference, you know, the AR as semi-automatic is completely fine with me.
And you like it as a shooting,
right,
to go to a shooting range.
Right, yeah. I mean, people ask me, or you know, we talked yesterday, why I like owning guns,
mm-hmm,
why I think it's almost considered a hobby.
Mm-hmm.
I enjoy guns. I enjoy shooting guns. I enjoy the recreational aspect of it. Mm-hmm. Many of my guns are, and as with other people, are collectibles. Some of them more expensive than others. They usually maintain value. I enjoy cleaning them. I enjoy working on them. It's just like a hobby. Some people mm-hmm. like cars. Some people like jewelry, whatever. I like guns. And most, mm-hmm. like I said, most military police guys you talk to, that's kind of the same thing. Uh-huh. They fall under uh-huh. there.
Now, what do you think about background checks?
I think they're a great idea. I am no way opposed to a background check. In other words, it does not bother me to go to a store to purchase a weapon and I feel offended because I have to give them my information and let them run it through a background check. Mm-hmm. That is a way that's a method we use to ensure that we're keeping the guns out of the hands of people that don't need them, mm-hmm. At least from a buyer-seller standpoint.
Is this a federal regulation or state by state by state?
I believe that the ATF is uh-huh. the main, the Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms uh-huh. are the main governing agency when it comes to background checks. Mm-hmm. As far as I know, it's pretty standard across all states. When you go to buy a gun, you have to obviously, depending on what type of gun you're getting, you have to be a resident of the state. In other words, a Arkansas resident cannot come to Tennessee and purchase a handgun because they're not a resident of Tennessee.
Can they buy a
shotgun, a muzzleloader, I don't think a rifle. I think mm-hmm. rifle and pistols are the ones that you would have to have transferred to your home state to an mm-hmm. FFL dealer, mm-hmm. federal firearms license dealer. To actually complete the sale. Mm-hmm. But when you go to buy a gun, it's pretty much standard. You fill out 4473, which is the form, mm-hmm. And they ask you a variety of questions, and based upon how you answer, that can determine whether or not you're suitable for the gun.
Mm-hmm. So, are there any problems with this?
I definitely think there's some ways we could shore this up. The biggest thing we're going to have to focus on now when we talk about, and I think kind of what President Obama is leaning towards here, when we talk about these mass shootings, these school shootings and things like that where a high number of casualties are occurring, we're not talking about your average street criminal. We're usually talking about people who have been suffering or are suffering from some sort of mental illness, usually quite severe. And I think what you're going to see here in the coming months and years is a way to try to, again, shore up that connection between mental illness and the likelihood that you might use this gun for, or use a gun for carrying out a crime, such mm-hmm. as a mass shooting. Mm-hmm.
Go ahead. Are there any examples that you can think of?
Well, yeah. I mean, you look at Newtown, Connecticut. Mm-hmm. You look at Columbine. As a matter mm-hmm. of fact, my students right now, we're profiling criminals, and many of them are choosing, the individual that shot up the movie theater in Colorado. Mm-hmm. That holds a lot of people's interest because it's such a traumatic and terrible thing. You know, uh-huh. it's innocent people are being killed, and many of them. There's a high number of casualties. Mm-hmm. And so there's a lot of focus on that, and I think that's really what President Obama is kind of gearing his legislation towards, mm-hmm. is a way to shore up, because there is a question on the 4473. I think it reads something along the lines of, have you ever been adjudicated as mentally ill by a judge?
Good. Hold that thought.
Okay.
We're going to come right back. We have to take a short break.
All right.
Yeah. We have to take a short break. We'll have more with Chad Uhiron when we return. Please stay with us.
Pretty much good day for me would be people leaving their hands off of me. I'm always called names. Everywhere that I go, there's always someone calling me names, calling me gay. I've been choked, thrown up against the wall, punched. Nobody's ever tried to help me.
Thank you.
are watching Germantown Municipal Television, your source for everything Germantown.
Welcome back to Mid-South Matters. Today's show is focusing on gun control. Discussing this heated topic is Chad Uhiron, criminal justice teacher and reserve police officer. And let's talk about mental health and loopholes in the law.
Right. When we left off before the break, I was mentioning there was a question that asked you about, I'm summarizing here, but something along the lines of, have you been adjudicated by a judge as being mentally ill or having a mental illness?
And that's
illness?
The standard? That has right. to be before you're
right.
considered?
Right. And if you, according to the form.
Mm-hmm.
And basically, you check yes or no, and then if you check, I mean, but who's going to check no on themselves or yes mm-hmm. on themselves and mm-hmm. automatically decline the sale?
Mm-hmm.
The problem here that we run into is there's really no way, as far as I know, to really verify these answers. And so if you know, even if you are mentally ill and probably don't need a gun, you can forge the document or you can answer wrongfully there,
mm-hmm.
and there's no way to verify those answers.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's where the Congress and legislation and everything is going to have to try to figure out a way, some system that we can verify whether or not potential gun buyers are in fact to the degree of suffering from a mental illness to where they do not need a gun.
Yeah.
Because let me say this, not all people with mental illnesses should not be declined
right.
the right to bear arms. That's not what I'm saying, but I think there are people out here definitely who have problems or issues that maybe lend themselves to them not needing a gun.
Right. It seems like there are two problems here. One, how do you find out who's
right.
who's been adjudicated
right.
as
exactly.
having a serious mental illness? I think that could probably be addressed. You could have a database. I mean, the criminal system is
right.
online everywhere,
mm-hmm.
so
right.
there could be. But not everybody who should not own a gun has been declared
right.
unfit.
You're exactly right. And another thing you're going to run into with this that's going to be interesting to see how they approach it. Now that you're actually bringing in medical records as opposed to criminal records, HIPAA laws and things like that
uh-huh.
that's going to be a whole nother issue down the road that I can foresee mm-hmm. coming on the horizon. But yeah, definitely, we need to figure out a better way to check this, to verify this. You know, it's easy to check to see if you're a felon or not. We have NCIC checks and things like that, and it's quite easy to see that.
Mm-hmm.
But with mental illness, people that are suffering from severe mental illness may not be as easy, and that's kind of the million-dollar question, is how do we go about verifying these people to make sure they're suitable for gun ownership.
Right. What about in background checks, what mm-hmm. other problems are there?
Well, in addition to the mental illness, which is what we focused on up to this point, you also have issues of people, what we call straw purchases. That is basically where you get someone, you know beforehand that you're going to be declined the right to buy the gun. So you have a buddy, a family member, someone else that actually goes in, purchases a gun, does all the paperwork in their name, and then as soon as they walk out the store, they hand you the gun and that's it. You give them the money or whatever, and that's, they basically buy the gun for you.
Mm-hmm.
We refer to that as a straw purchase, and that is something that's also hard to combat at times. You know, who's buying the gun, you know, who's trying to buy it for someone else. It can be complicated.
On this form, this mm-hmm. 4473.
Mm-hmm.
Is there a question that says, are you buying
right.
this gun
if
for somebody else?
If there's a question there, I want to say it's the first one. I could be wrong. But it's, you are the person that is purchasing this gun.
Mm-hmm.
And to violate that is actually could be prosecuted, you know, federally for that. So,
mm-hmm.
But how do we catch those people? That's the question.
Mm-hmm.
It sounds good on the form, but how do we vet mm-hmm. those people and make sure that that's actually what mm-hmm. is happening?
You worked in a place that sold guns, mm-hmm. and you learned how to kind of spot this.
Right.
How do you?
Well, it just takes it takes time. After you see it once or twice, you kind of get the hang of it. You know, they'll teach you about it in training because I worked at Bass Pro Shops, and we had to go through quite a bit of training before we were allowed to sell guns. And one of the things they talked about was straw purchases. And, you know, just for example, you have two people come up to the counter to look at guns, and one of them's kind of standing back, and the other one's the one that's kind of asking, hey, can I look at that one? You know, what caliber is this? What's the capacity on that? And it's almost like he's the puppet for the guy standing behind him. Uh-huh. He turns and looks at him, and, you know, he's, is this, you know, that type uh-huh. of thing. And so mm-hmm. for those situations, it's pretty obvious that that's what's occurring. Mm-hmm. But in other situations where they're not even together, you know, maybe the person who can't own the gun is out in the parking lot, mm-hmm. not even in the store, that presents some problems. Mm-hmm. That is quite a bit harder to determine.
I think that actually happened in California with one of these.
I'm sure, yeah. It's probably happened quite a bit. It's just we don't know about it.
Yeah.
So that's another way to get around the system. You know, that's another way to kind of circumvent the whole mm-hmm. background check, things like that.
Mm-hmm. Do most gun shops, businesses, have this kind of training? Is that pretty standard, or is Bass Pro a little ahead of the crowd?
Well, you know, Bass Pro is a major retailer, so they maybe have more access to more sophisticated training. I can't speak for local gun shops because I've not worked there, but I would like to say they go through adequate training because it's a fairly big deal to have the license to sell. I mean, I just can speak with my experience. It was pretty strenuous training that you had to go through, different tests you have to take and things like that. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I would believe that would be a standard across all gun shops, mm-hmm. from the mom and pop mm-hmm. stores all the way up to like Walmart.
I don't remember exactly where it is, but it's been recently, mm-hmm. this year, right. 2016. The responsibility for a crime committed with a gun actually went back to the gun shop owner. Apparently, he should not have sold the gun. Do you know what the case I'm talking about?
It wasn't the shooting out in California with the where they shot.
Maybe, but
I think they caught that guy that actually bought the guns for them, but I could be mistaken.
They did get, yes.
Yeah. Uh-huh. I don't know if they've traced it back further to the dealer or anything uh-huh. else.
But I do know. Yeah. I think that's an interesting phenomenon. If the dealer knows he will be held responsible, then that...
Right. Yeah. Obviously, it puts a lot more on the dealers to do their job.
Yes.
Right, exactly.
And we'll be back in another minute.
All right.
Chad will return for our final segment after this short break. Please stay with us.
Cinderella found the pet that fits her perfectly. Tiana gave her pet the royal treatment. Belle found beauty where no one else did. And you can too. Share your heart. Share your love. Bring home your forever friend. Make a shelter pet part of your world. Happily Ever After begins at theshelterpetproject.org.
They say that when you're facing extreme danger, your life flashes before you. If you think that's sad, consider facing it before you even have enough life to flash before your eyes. Deaths and injuries can be prevented by using the right car seat. Visit safercar.gov/the right seat to know what is appropriate for each age and size.
You are watching Germantown Municipal Television, your source for everything Germantown.
Welcome back. We're talking with criminal justice teacher and reserve police officer Chad Uhiron. Welcome back, Chad.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Now, tell me exactly where we stopped.
We were talking about holding dealers, accountable for
right.
things that might happen if they knowingly sell a gun to someone that maybe shouldn't have a gun.
Shouldn't have one, yeah. Tell me about ways that a background check can go wrong or is not...
Well,
handled properly, I
guess. It's when you fill out the 4473, the person that's actually selling the gun has to verify the information.
How long does that take? If I fill it out,
it's become a lot more sophisticated nowadays. I know at Bass Pro, when things were working right internet-wise and things like that, I could have you out the door in probably 30 minutes.
Didn't it used to take 3 days?
It used to take 3 or 4 days, yeah. But now with technology, we're able to tap in directly to the TBI, which is Tennessee Bureau of Investigation, and they're able to vet people and make sure that they're on the up and up as far as gun ownership. So I know with Bass Pro, everything was pretty much done electronically. And then I would submit your information through to TBI for their NCIC check. And usually within a few minutes, they come back approved or not approved.
You get many not approved?
From time to time, you have a few. And at that point, of course, you obviously cancel the sale. The person can then call TBI to infer about what is actually holding them up, because sometimes there's things in the past that should have been expunged or taken off the record that didn't get removed, and things like that.
Yeah.
So they do have an avenue that they can go. It's almost like a little appeal process to see if there was some sort of error or something like that. But for the most part, I mean, I didn't have that many. Most of the people seem to know whether or not they could
legally
own a gun before they came
right.
in there, because
right.
I'm sure it's quite embarrassing to have that pop up that you can't buy a gun.
Can't buy it, yeah.
So.
Yeah. Let's talk about gun shows, because that seems to be a big bone of contention for everybody.
Right. Gun shows.
Explain exactly what a gun show is.
Well, a gun show is, we have them from time to time here. You'll see the billboards up around town. We usually have them at the Agri Center. It's where many different dealers come together.
Are these big dealers? Is Bass Pro going to be there?
No, these will usually be smaller scale dealers. Some of them may not even have an actual store that they work out of. It'll be ammunition, guns of all types, things like that. And it's kind of like a one-stop shop for gun owners and things of that nature. The one problem that you run into with gun shows is it's a lot of hand-to-hand transactions. How do you get around that, or how do you circumvent that problem? Because obviously there's no way really to vet or to verify that this person can't own a gun. So it's not quite up to par with the actual store purchases when you go in and fill out the forms and things like that. Now, having said that, many of the booths that are set up at the gun show will still do 4473s and things like that. But there's so many people walking around. You can bring your guns with you if you want to. They'll check them at the door. But you can bring your guns with you, and you can try to sell your guns and things like that. So there are some loopholes there.
Yes, because you just said dealers have to go through, it's difficult to get a license to sell, but it seems like this is wide open.
Well, and when I talk about a lot of the hand-to-hand transactions, you might have, you might bring a gun to potentially sell, and I may be there just walking around, and I bump into you, and you say, hey, or I have this gun, or you might be interested. Well, yeah, sure. And then exchange money, and then I'm out on my way. That's kind of the problems that you run into, not so much with the actual vendors that are there, but it's kind of the people that are there, people that are coming to look at the gun show or bring their own guns. Sometimes you can have those types of transactions happen, and obviously there's really no way to verify who you're selling the gun to.
Didn't the Columbine teenagers buy their guns at a gun show?
I can't recall off the top of my head. I don't know if they did or if they got it. They acquired the guns from a relative or something like that.
I think it was a gun show.
I think with Newtown, which has been a lot more recent, I think he actually got the gun from his parents.
From his mother.
Yeah.
Well, we don't have a whole lot of time left. Let's talk about open carry and concealed carry, and what the difference is and how you get those and what you think about that.
Okay. Well, the major difference between the two is open carry, as the name suggests, means that you are openly carrying a gun, meaning you're not trying to conceal it. Think of police officers in regular uniforms. That's an open carry. We have our gun out. You can see our gun. It's quite obvious. Mm-hmm. Concealed carry, on the other hand, is just what the name suggests. You conceal the gun, either tuck it in your pants or wear an ankle holster or something like that.
What about a woman putting it
in a
purse?
Is that concealed? That's concealed. Anything where it's not just out and open and you're broadcasting it for everyone to see. Depending on the states, some states allow open carry. Some states do not. It really just depends. I think Texas is one that allows it. Mississippi, I believe, is also one. As far as my opinion on the matter, I look at it, I guess, from my police training, from a tactical standpoint. The reason we carry guns in the first place in public is to protect ourselves, our family, and innocent third-party people from criminals. From a tactical advantage, I think carrying concealed is the best way to go. I'll give you an example. If I'm standing in a bank, getting ready to cash a check, and a guy walks in and he's going to rob the store, and I have a 40 strapped to my hip, a 40 caliber handgun, and he can see that, well, I become target number one because he knows I'm his primary threat. Whereas the element of surprise is always better. I would prefer him not know right off the bat that I'm the one armed and therefore mm-hmm. Shoot me or something mm-hmm. like that. Mm-hmm. So from a tactical advantage, in my opinion, it's much better to go concealed. And just another thing, there's people that are not comfortable with guns being out. And so you try to respect those people too, uh-huh. because some people get uh-huh. uncomfortable, and I understand that. Mm-hmm. And so, if you don't know that's there, then maybe you'll be a little more comfortable and not freak out or whatever. Mm-hmm. So
you really prefer concealed carry?
When I carry my gun pretty much everywhere except to school.
School, it's illegal for you to be here, right? As a police officer, may change.
It's a touchy subject. It's for me, it would probably be a little easier to carry because I'm a commissioned officer. I've gone through adequate training and things like that. But I still, we have two outstanding officers here that work with us. And so I defer to them just to keep it professional and you don't want to freak the kids out or anything like that. But other than that, I mean, I take my gun everywhere because you just never know. Yeah. But you'll never know I have it on me.
Okay. So. Tell you what, next time we'll talk about training and the kind of training you should have.
Awesome. Yeah, I'd love to come
right
back
now,
and talk some more.
We're finished.
Okay.
Can you believe? I am here to thank my guest and thank you at home for watching this month's edition of Mid-South Matters. If you'd like more information about this or any other show on Germantown Municipal Television, please visit our website at www.gmtvonline.org. Thanks again, and we'll see you next month. So,